Hello, everyone. Happy April. I'm Jared. This is the Quarantine Theater Company, and we are here with the read of Phantom of the Opera, which closed on Broadway 1 year ago. So we're here to bring it back. And we've got a great cast of 10 of us today. We have Tyler, who will be reading our scene description. We have Kevin, who will be reading as the Phantom. We have Lorelai, who will be reading as Christine. Thea, who will be reading as Meg. Logan, who will be reading as Firmin. Paul, who is reading as Andre. Chelsea, who will be reading as Carlotta. And Eric, who will be reading as Pianji. We have Travis as Bouquet and others. And I will be reading as Raoul. So here we are, Phantom of the Opera. Make sure you're unmuted if you're speaking.
The stage of the Paris Opera, 1911. The proscenium is shrouded on both sides with China silk dust cloths, stressed and streaked by age. On stage center, shrouded, is a chandelier. The contents of the opera house are being auctioned off. An auctioneer, porters, bidders, and elderly, MME, Giry, and Raoul, near 60 now, but still bright of eye, are present. The auctioneer commences with a blow from the auctioneer's gavel.
Sold! Your number, sir. Thank you. Lot 663, then. Ladies and gentlemen, a poster from this year's house production of Hannibal by Schellmuth.
Showing here.
Do I have 10 francs? Five, then. Yes, five. I am bid. 6, 6. Do I have C7? 7, 7 against yours, sir. 7, 8, 8, 8, 1. Selling twice. Sold to Raoul Vicomte de Changi. Thank you very much. Lot 664, then, ladies and gentlemen, a wooden pistol and three human skulls from the 1831 production of Robert Louis d'Able by Meyerbeer. 10 francs for this. 10, thank you. 10, I am bid. 10 francs still. 15, thank you, sir. 15, I am bid. Going at 15. Your number, sir, lot 665, ladies and gentlemen, a papier-mâché musical box in the shape of a barrel organ attached. The figure of a monkey in a Persian robes playing the syllables. This item, discovered in the vaults of the theater, still in working order.
Showing here.
May I commence at 20 francs? Oh, come, ladies and gentlemen. 15 then. 15 I am bid. Thank you. Yes, 20 from you, sir. Thank you very much.
25.
25 on my left. Thank you, madam. 25, I am bid. 30, selling at 30 francs, then 30 once, 30 twice. Sold for 30 francs to the Vicomte de Changi. Thank you once again, sir.
Boy.
The box is handed across to Raoul. He studies it as his attention focuses on him for a moment.
A collector's piece, indeed. Every detail, exactly as she said. She often spoke of you, my friend. Your velvet lining and your figurine of lead. Will you still play when all the rest of us are dead?
Lot 666, then, a chandelier in pieces. Some of you may recall the strange affair to the Phantom of the Opera, mystery never fully explained. We are told, ladies and gentlemen, that this is the very chandelier which figures in the famous disaster. Our workshops have restored it and fitted parts of it with wiring to the new electric light so that we may get a hint of how it may look when reassembled. Perhaps we may frighten away the ghost of so many years with a little illumination. gentlemen.
The auctioneer switches on the chandelier. There's an enormous flash and the overture begins. During the overture, the opera house is restored to its earlier grandeur. The chandelier, immense and glittering, rises magically from the stage, finally hovering high above the orchestra. Act 1, Paris, 1881, Scene 1. Rehearsals for Hannibal. We have reached the great choral scene in which Hannibal and his army return to Carthage from the Roman invasion under Scipio. Hannibal is Ubaldo Piangi, Elissa, Queen of Carthage. His mistress is Carlotta. Giudicelli, Meg Geary, and Christine play the two leading slave girls. Emma Mee Geary is the ballet mistress. Monsieur Reyer, the repetiteur, is in charge. We join the opera towards the end of Elissa's great aria. She is alone, holding a present from the approaching Hannibal, a bleeding severed head wearing a Roman bay wreath.
These trophies from our saviors, from our saviors, from the enslaving force of Rome.
Enter the rest of the chorus. Slave girls, slave master, flunkies, a wild man, a wild woman, and a princess.
And dancing and song, tonight in celebration, we greet the victorious dawn, return to bring salvation.
The trumpets of Carthage sound, hear trumpets now and tremble, hark to our step on the ground, hear the trumpets, Hannibal comes.
The offstage chorus crashes in and approaches Hannibal's army.
Piangi, Hannibal enters. Sad to return to find the land we love, threatened once more by Roma's far-reaching glass.
Entering from offstage, interrupting him.
No, Signor, if you please, Rome, we must stay.
Rome, not Roma. A stagehand carries a ladder across the stage. Others are seen, still constructing parts of the scenery, hammering and shouting.
Si, Rome, not Roma. It's very hard for me. Rome.
Enter the retiring manager of the opera. With M. Mayer and Monsieur André, to whom he has just sold it.
Once again, if you please, Signor, sad to return.
This way, gentlemen, this way. Rehearsals, as you see, are underway for a new production of Chalumeau's Hannibal. Ladies and gentlemen, some of you may already perhaps have met Signor André and Monsieur Firmin.
The new managers are politely bowing. When Reyer interrupts.
I'm sorry, Mr. Lefebvre. We are rehearsing, if you wouldn't mind waiting a moment.
My apologies, Monsieur Reyer. Proceed.
Thank you, Monsieur. Sad to return, Signor.
M. Reyer, our chief repertoire. Rather a tyrant, I'm afraid.
Rehearsal continues.
Sad to return to find the land we love, threatened once more by Rome's far-reaching grasp. Tomorrow night we shall break the chains of Rome. Tonight rejoice, your army has come home.
Hannibal descends and takes Elissa in his arms. They turn to watch the dance. The slave girls are on their feet with finger cymbals at the ready. Lefebvre and André and Fermaire stand center stage, watching the ballet. They are in the way. The ballet continues under the following dialogue.
Signor Piangi, our principal tenor, he does play so well opposite La Carlotta.
Gentlemen, please, if you would kindly stand to one side.
My apologies, Madame Giry. Madame Giry, our ballet mistress. I don't mind confessing, Monsieur Firmin, I shan't be sorry to be rid of the whole blessed business.
Keep asking you, monsieur, why exactly are you retiring?
We take particular pride here in the excellence of our ballets.
The ballet girls dance on. Carlotta and Piangi also attempt a rather portly dance of seduction while the girls whirl around them. Meg becomes prominent among the dancers.
Who's that girl, Lefebvre?
Her? Meg Giry, Madame Giry's daughter. Promising dancer, Monsieur André. Most promising.
You, Christine Daae, concentrate, girl.
Christine, what's the matter?
Daae. Curious name.
Swedish.
Any relation to the violinist?
His daughter, I believe. Always had her head in the clouds, I'm afraid.
The ballet continues to its climax and ends. The chorus resumes.
Bid welcome to Hannibal's guest, the elephants of Carthage, as guides on your conquering quest, to defend.
The elephant, a life-size mechanical replica, enters. Piangi is lifted in triumph onto its back.
Once more to my welcoming arms, my life returns in splendor.
Once more to the sweetness of charms, my heart and soul surrender.
The trumpeting elephant sound,
hear Romans now and tremble. Up to the steps on the crown,
hear the chant!
At the end of the chorus, Lefebvre stands for silence. The elephant is let off. Two stagehands are revealed operating it inside.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please? Madame Giry.
Giry bangs her cane on the stage. Silence.
Thank you. As you know, for some weeks there have been rumors of my imminent retirement. I can now tell you that these were all true, and it is my pleasure to introduce you to the two gentlemen who now own the Opera Populaire, Monsieur Richard Firmin and Monsieur Giles André.
Polite applause, some bowing. Carlotta makes her presence felt.
Gentlemen, Signora Carlotta Guidicelli, our leading soprano for 5 seasons now.
Of course, I've experienced all of your greatest roles, Signora.
And Signor Ubaldo Piangi?
An honor, Signor.
If I remember rightly, Alyssa has a rather fine aria in Act 3 of Hannibal. I wonder, Signora, if, as a personal favor, you would oblige us with a private rendition? Unless, of course, Monsieur Rayer.
My manager commands, Monsieur Rayer.
Diva commands, will 2 bars be sufficient introduction?
2 bars will be quite sufficient.
Signora?
Maestro.
She nods. Rayer takes the introduction on the piano.
Think of me fondly when we've said goodbye. Remember me. Every so often, promise me you'll try. On that day, that not so distant day, excuse me, when you are far away and free, if you ever find a moment, spare.
singing, backdrop crashes to the floor, cutting her off. The following dialogue is also simultaneous.
He's here, the
Phantom of the Opera.
You idiots!
It's the ghost.
He's here.
He is with us.
Good heavens, will you show a little courtesy?
Mademoiselle, please!
Signora, are you all right? Bouquet, where is Bouquet? Get this man down here.
Good sir, for a prima donna.
Bouquet, what's going on?
Please, Monsieur, don't look at me as God's my witness. I'm not at my post. Please, Monsieur, there's no one there. If there is, well, then it must be a ghost.
He's there, the Phantom of the Opera.
Good heavens, I've never known such insolence.
Signora, please. These things do happen.
These things do happen. You have been here 5 minutes. What do you know? See, these things do happen all the time. For the past 3 years, these things do happen. And did you stop it from happening? No. And you too, you're as bad as him. These things do happen. Well, until you stop these things from happening, this thing does not happen. Ubaldo, Udamamo.
Amateurs!
I don't think there's much more to assist you, gentlemen. Good luck. If you need me, I shall be in Frankfurt.
He leaves. The company looks anxiously as the new managers.
La Carlotta will be back.
Sorry, what is that?
So, messieurs, I have a message here, sir, from the opera ghost.
The girls twitter and twirl in fear.
God in heaven, you're all obsessed.
He merely welcomes you to his opera house and commands you to continue the leave box 5 empty for his use and reminds you that his salary is due.
His salary?
Monsieur Lefebvre paid him 20,000 francs a month. Perhaps you can afford more with the Vicomte de Chagny as your patron.
Reaction to this from the ballet girls. Christine takes hold of Meg nervously.
Madam, I had hoped to have made that announcement myself.
Will the Vicomte be at the performance tonight, monsieur?
In our box. Madam, who's the understudy for this role? Madame.
Monsieur Rayet, you want to answer that?
Travis.
There is no understudy, Monsieur. I'm sorry, the production is new and so am I.
Christine Daae could sing it, sir.
Horace girl.
She has been taking lessons from a great teacher.
From whom?
I don't know, sir.
No, not as well. Not you as well. Can you believe it? A full house and we have to cancel.
Let her sing for you, monsieur. She has been well taught.
From the beginning of the area, then, Mom City French gentleman.
Think of me fondly. When we've said goodbye, remember me ever so oft. and promise me you'll try.
Andre, this is doing nothing for my nerves.
Don't fret, Furman.
On that day, that not-so-distant day, when you are far away and free, if you ever find a moment, spare a thought for me.
The lights dim and the surroundings dissolve as we are transported to the gala. Christine is revealed in full costume. She is now accompanied by an orchestra. Stage boxes appear on either side.
And though it's clear, though it was always clear, that this was never meant to be, if you happen to remember, stop and think of me. Think of when the trees were green. Don't think about the way things might have been. Think of me. Think of me waking silent and resigned. Imagine me trying too hard to put you from my mind. Think of me, please say you'll think of me, whatever you choose to do. There will never be a day when I won't think of you.
Applause, bravos. Prominent among the bravos, those of the young Raoul in the manager's box with the various aristocrats.
Can it be? Can it be Christine? Brava! Brava! Long ago, it seems so long ago, how young and innocent we were. She may not remember me, but I remember her.
Flowers fade, the fruits of summer fade, they have their season, so do we. But please promise me that sometimes you will think.
After the gala. Reverse view of the stage. The applause continues and we see Christine from behind taking her bows. The house curtains close upstage, and ballet girls from the wings gush around Christine, who hands each a flower from her bouquet. Rier stiffly gives his approval when Jerry appears.
Yes. Yes, you did well. He will be pleased. And you were a disgrace tonight. Such rond de jambe, such tant de crise. Come, we rehearse now.
She emphasizes this with her cane. The ballet girls settle into rehearsal upstage, Giri keeping time with her stick. Variations on this continue throughout the scene. Christine moves slowly downstage away from the dancers as her dressing room becomes visible. Unseen by her, Meg also moves away and follows her. As Christine is about to open the dressing room door, she hears the phantom's voice out of nowhere. The dancer's music has faded out.
Brava! Brava! Bravissima!
Christine, Christine.
Christine.
Christine is bewildered by the voice. Meg, following, has not heard it. Music continues until Meg enters the room. Christine turns in surprise and is relieved to see her.
Where in the world have you been hiding? Really, you were perfect. I only wish I knew your secret. Who is this new tutor?
Father once spoke of an angel. I used to dream he'd appear. Now as I sing, I can sense him, and I know he's here. Here in this room, he calls me softly, somewhere inside, hiding. Somehow I know he's always with me, he, the unseen genius.
Christine, you must have been dreaming. Stories like this can't come true. Christine, you're talking in riddles, and it's not like you.
Music, guide, and guardian, grant to me your glory.
Who is this angel, this
angel of music? Hide no longer. Secret and strange angel, he's with me even now.
Your hands are cold
all around me.
Your face, Christine, it's white.
It frightens me.
Be frightened.
Meg Giry, are you a dancer? Then go and practice. My dear, I was asked to give you this. A red scarf, the attic, little Lottie.
Scene 3, Christine's dressing room. Meanwhile, Raoul, André, Femmer, and Madame Femmer are seen making their way towards the dressing room. The manager's in high spirits, bearing champagne.
A tour de force! No other way to describe it.
Relief! Not a single refund!
Greedy.
Richard, I think we've made quite a discovery in Miss Dye.
Here we are, Monsieur le Vicomte.
Gentlemen, if you wouldn't mind, I think this is one visit I should prefer to make unaccompanied.
As you wish, Monsieur.
Thank you.
They appear to have met before.
Christine Daae, where is your red scarf? Mute.
Monsieur?
You can't have lost it. After all the trouble I took, I was just 14 and soaked to the skin.
Because you had run into the sea to fetch my scarf. Oh, Raoul, so it is you.
Christine.
They embrace and laugh. She moves away and sits at a dressing table.
Little Lottie, let her mind wander.
You remember that too.
Little Lottie, thought, am I fonder of dolls?
Or of goblins, of shoes, or of riddles, or frocks?
Those picnics in the attics, or of chocolates?
Father, playing the violin.
As we read to each other dark stories of the North.
Know what I love best, Lottie said, is when I'm asleep in my bed and the angel of music sings songs in my head. The angel of music sings songs in my head. Father said, when I'm in heaven, child, I will send the angel of music to you. Well, Father is dead, Raoul, and I have been visited by the angel of music.
Oh, no doubt of it. And now we'll go to supper.
No. Raoul, the angel of music is very strict.
I shan't keep you late.
No, Raoul. Things have changed.
You must change. I must get my hat. 2 minutes, little Lottie.
Raoul. Things have changed, Raoul.
Tremulous music. Christine hears the phantom's voice, seemingly from behind her dressing room mirror.
Insolent boy, the slave of fashion, basking in your glory. ignorant fool, this brave young suitor, sharing in my triumph.
I hear you speak, I listen, stay by my side, guide me. Angel, my soul was weak, forgive me, enter at last, master.
Flattering child, you shall know me, see why in shadow I hide. Look at your face in the mirror, I am there inside.
Love your sick guide and guardian, grant to me your glory. Hide no longer, come to me, strange angel.
I am your angel of music. Come to me, angel of music.
Christine walks towards the glowing, shimmering glass. Meanwhile, Raoul has returned. He hears the voices and is puzzled. He tries the door. It is locked.
Whose is that voice? Who is that in there?
Inside the room, the mirror opens. Behind it, in an inferno of white light, stands the phantom. He reaches forward and takes Christine firmly, but not fiercely, by the wrist. His touch is cold, and Christine gasps.
I am your angel of music. Come to me, angel of music.
Christine disappears through the mirror, which closes behind her. The door of the dressing room suddenly unlocks and swings open, and Raoul enters to find the room empty.
Christine! Angel!
The labyrinth underground. Subterranean gloom, through which we can discern the phantom leading Christine through the darkness, deeper and deeper below the opera house, towards the phantom's lair, disappearing first into a trap door in the stage. They then almost immediately reappear high above the stage, descending by an immense zigzagging walkway. Candles rise from the stage, and we see Christine and the phantom in a boat, which moves slowly across the misty waters of an underground lake.
In sleep he sang to me, in dreams he came, that voice which calls to me and speaks my name. And do I dream again? For now I find the fire. Some of the opera is there inside my mind.
Sing once again with me our strange duet. My power over you grows stronger yet. And though you turn from me to glance behind, the phantom of the opera is there inside your mind.
Those who have seen your face draw back in fear. I am the mask you wear.
It's me they hear. My spirit and your voice in one combined. The phantom of the opera is there inside your mind.
He's there, the phantom of the opera. Beware
the Phantom of the Opera.
In all your fantasies, you always knew that man and mystery
were both in you. And
in this labyrinth,
where
night is blind,
the
Phantom of the Opera is there inside your mind. Sing, my angel of music.
He's there, the Phantom of the Opera.
Sing for me. Sing, my angel of music. Sing for me.
Beyond the lake. As Christine reaches her climactic note, we arrive in the Phantom's lair. Downstage, the candles in the lake have lifted to reveal giant candelabras outlining the space. The boat turns into a bed occupying the center of the stage, which is otherwise dominated by a huge pipe organ on one side, an even larger mirror on the other side, the latter covered by a dust sheet. The Phantom sits at the organ and takes over the accompaniment.
I have brought you to the seat of sweet music's throne, to this kingdom where almost homage to music. Music. You have come here for one purpose and one alone. Since the moment I first heard you sing, I have needed you with me to serve me, to sing for my music. My music. Nighttime sharpens, heightens each sensation. Darkness stirs and wakes imagination. Silently the senses abandon their defenses. Slowly, gently, night unfurls its splendor. Grasp it, sense it, tremulous and tender. Turn your face away from the garish light of day. Turn your thoughts away from cold, unfeeling light. And listen to the music of the night. Close your eyes and surrender to your darkest dream. Purge your thoughts of the life you knew before. Close your eyes, let your spirit start to soar. And you'll live as you've never lived before. Softly, deftly, music shall surround you. Feel it, hear it, closing in around you. Open up your mind, let your fantasies unwind in this darkness which you know you cannot fight. the darkness of the music of the night. Let your mind start a journey to a strange new world. Leave all thoughts of the world you knew before. Let your soul take you where you long to be. Only then can you belong to me. Floating, falling, sweet intoxication. Touch me, trust me. Savor each sensation. Let the dream begin. Let your darkest side give in to the power that you know you cannot fight. The power of the music of the night.
During all this, the Phantom has conditioned Christine to the coldness of his touch, and her fingers are brave enough to stray his mask and caress it with no hint of removing it. The Phantom leads her to the mirror from which he removes the dust cover, and in which we see the image of Christine, a perfect wax face impression wearing a wedding gown. Christine moves slowly towards it, when suddenly the image thrusts its hands through the mirror towards her. She faints. The Phantom catches her and carries her to the bed, where he lays her down.
You alone can make my song take flight. Help me make the music of the night.
The next morning, the Phantom, in his Mandarin costume, is composing. Christine lies in the bed under gauze. As the light brightens, we see the Phantom seated at the organ, playing with furious concentration. He breaks off occasionally to write the music down. There is a music box in the shape of a barrel organ beside the bed. Mysteriously, its lid lifts and it plays as Christine wakes up. The music keeps her in a half trance.
There was mist, swirling mist upon a vast glossy lake. There were candles all around, and on the lake there was a boat. And in the boat there was a man.
She rises during the musical interlude and approaches the Phantom from behind. He does not see her as she reaches for his mask. He turns, almost catching her. This happens several times.
Who's that face in the shadows? Whose is the face in the mask?
She finally succeeds in tearing the mask from his face. The Phantom springs up and rounds on her furiously. She clearly sees his face. The audience does not, as he is standing in profile and in shadow.
Damn you, you little prime Pandora! You little demon, is this what you wanted to see? Curse you, you little lying Delilah! You little viper, now you can never be free. Damn you, curse you. Stranger than you dreamt it, can you even dare to look or bear to think of me? This loathsome gargoyle who burns in hell but secretly yearns for heaven. Secretly, secretly, Christine. fear can turn to love, you'll learn to see, to find the man behind the monster, this repulsive carcass who seems a beast but secretly dreams of beauty. Secretly, secretly. Christine.
A moment's pause as their eyes meet. He holds out his hand to the mask, which she gives to him. He puts it on, turning towards the audience as he sings.
Come, we must return. Those two fools who run my theater will be missing you.
The layer sinks into the floor. As the Phantom and Christine leave. Scene 7, backstage. Bouquet mysteriously appears, a length of fabric serving as a cloak and a piece of rope as the Punjab lasso he is showing off to the ballet girls.
Like yellow parchment is his skin. A great black hole served as the nose that never grew. The Punjab lasso.
Demonstrating his method of self-defense against the Punjab lasso, he inserts his hand between his neck and the noose, and then pulls the rope taut with a mixture of horror and delight. The ballet girls applaud this demonstration.
You must be always on your guard, or he will catch you with his magical lasso.
A trap opens up center stage, casting a shadow of the Phantom as he emerges. The girls, linking hands, run off terrified. The Phantom, leading Christine, fixes his stare at En Bouquet, sweeping his cape around Christine. He exits with her. But before they go, Jiri has entered, observing. She turns on Bouquet.
Those who speak of what they know find too late that prudent silence is wise. Joseph Bouquet, hold your tongue. He will burn you with the heat of his eyes.
Bouquet laughs and exits. The manager's office. Desk, chair, papers. Femin is scornfully eyeing a newspaper article.
Mystery after gala night, it's as mystery of Soprano's flight. Mystified, baffled Cerites say, we are mystified, we suspect foul play. Bad news on Soprano scene. First Carlotta, now Christine. Still, at least the seats get sold. Gossip's worth its weight in gold. Diva tenders resignation. Covered as a moonlight flit. Half your cast disappears, but the crowd still cheers. Opera! To hell with luck and handle, have a scandal, and you're sure to have a hit!
Damnable! Damnable! Will they all walk out? This is damnable!
Andre, please don't shout. It's publicity, and the take is vast free publicity!
But we have no cast!
But Andre, have you seen the queue? Oh, it seems you've got one too.
Dear Andre, what a charming gala. Christine enjoyed a great success. We were hardly bereft when Carlotta left. Otherwise, the chorus was entrancing, but the dancing was a lamentable mess.
Dear Herman, just a brief reminder. My salary has not been paid. Send a care of the ghost by return of post PTO. No one likes a debtor, so it's better if my orders are obeyed.
Who would have the gall to send this? Someone with a puerile brain.
These are both signed OG.
Who the hell is he?
Opera
ghost.
It's really not amusing.
He's abusing opposition.
In addition, he wants money.
He's a funny sort of specter.
To respect a large retainer, nothing plainer. He is clearly quite insane.
They are interrupted by the arrival of Raoul, who brandishes another of the Phantom's notes.
Where is she?
You mean Carlotta?
I mean Miss Dye, where is she?
Well, how should we know?
I want an answer. I take it that you sent me this note.
What's all this nonsense?
Of course not.
Don't look at us.
He's not with you then.
Of course not.
We're in the dock.
You sure don't argue. Isn't this the letter you wrote?
And what is it we're meant to have wrote? Written.
Do not fear for Miss Daye. The angel of music has her under his wing. Make no attempt to see her again.
If you didn't write it, who did?
Carlotta and Piangi burst in. She too has a letter, which has cheered her no more than the others.
Where is he?
Oh, welcome back.
Compassion's patient, where is he?
Now.
I have your letter, a letter which I rather resent.
Did you send it?
Of course not.
As if he would.
You didn't send it?
Of course not.
What's going on?
You dare to tell me that this is not the letter you sent?
And what is it that I meant to send? Christine, we'll be singing on your behalf tonight. Be prepared for a great misfortune should you attempt to take her place.
Far too many notes for my taste. And most of them about Christine. All we've heard since we came is Miss Daye's name.
Miss Daye has returned.
Which case I think our meeting is adjourned.
Where precisely is she now?
I thought it best that she went home.
She needed rest.
May I see her?
No, monsieur, she will see no one.
Will she sing? Will she sing?
Here, I have a note.
Let me see it!
Please!
Gentlemen, I have now sent you several notes of the most amiable nature, detailing how my theatre is to be run. You have not followed my instructions, so I shall give you...
One last chance. Christine Daye has returned to you, and I'm anxious her career should progress. And in the new production of Il Muto, you will therefore cast Carlotta as the page boy and put Miss Daye in the role of Countess. The role which Miss Daye plays calls for charm and appeal. The role of the page boy is silent, which makes my casting, in a word, ideal. I shall watch the performance from my normal seat in Box 5, which will be kept empty for me. Should these commands be ignored, a disaster beyond your imagination will occur.
I remain your
Christine!
What's her next?
It's
all a ploy to help Christine!
This is strange.
I know who sent this! The Vidmont, her lover!
Indeed.
Can you believe this?
How can you do this?
Signora!
This is a joke.
You are a star.
And always weeping.
The man is mad. We don't take orders.
Miss Daye, page boy.
The silent bro.
Carlotta will be playing the lead.
You don't deserve her.
It's useless trying to
please her.
You're only saying this to
please her.
Signorina, no,
who scorned his word, wet nose.
You have revolved me.
Angel knows why.
You have rebuilt me.
Signora, pardon us.
You have replaced me.
Please Prima Donna, first lady of the stage, your devotees are on their knees to implore you. Can you bow out when they're shouting your name?
Think of how they all adore you.
Prima Donna, enchant us once again. Think of your muse.
And of the queues round the theatre.
Can you deny us the triumphant store sing, Prima Donna once more?
Carlotta registers her acceptance as the managers continue to cajole. And the others reflect variously on the situation, their voices overlapping and interjecting other verses.
Prima Donna, your song shall live again.
Think of your public.
But there's a public who needs you. Think of their cry of follow where the light is
upon her.
Is this a ghost, an angel?
Leading ladies are a trial.
Prima Donna, your song shall never die. You'll sing again unto unending ovation.
When she sings, we see heaven.
Heaven is not
unending ovation now and always.
Blessed damnation, which has light.
Think how you'll shine in that final encore.
Fool, you have grouted.
Warning,
heads will roll.
Surely there'll be further scenes worse than this. Sing
Prima Donna
once more.
If his threats and demanded rejected.
Would we
Although he must have been,
but it's a song, and it
These demands are not met, a disaster beyond your imagination will occur.
A performance of Il Muto Balbrizio. Stage of the opera house, the red house curtains are in, the footlights are raised. During the overture, Raoul André and Femme take their respective seats. Raoul in box 5, the managers in the box opposite.
Gentlemen, if you would care to take your seats, I shall be sitting in box 5.
Do you really think that's wise, monsieur?
My dear André, there would appear to be no other seats available other than box 5.
The overture comes to an end. The house curtains part to reveal an 18th century salon, elegant, baroque, Barry Salzburg. The canopied bed, center stage, the Countess is played by Carlotta. Serafimo, the page boy, is disguised as her maid and is played by Christine. At this point, they are hidden behind the drapes of the bed, which are drawn. In the room are two fops, one a hairdresser and one a jeweler. The jeweler is attended by Meg. There's also an older woman, the Countess, confidante, all apart from Meg, are gossiping with relish about the Countess, current liaison with Serafimo.
They say that this youth has set my lady's heart aflame.
His lordship sure would die of shock.
His lordship is a laughingstock.
Should he suspect her, God protect her.
Shame. This faithless lady's bound for Hades.
Shame.
The canopy drapes part, and we see the Countess kissing Serafimo passionately. As the recitative begins, the lights and music dim on stage, and our attention turns to the managers in their box.
Nothing like the old operas.
Or the old scenery.
The old singers.
The old audience.
And every seat sold.
Hardly a disaster beyond all imagination.
They chuckle and nod to Raoul in the opposite box. He acknowledges them, attention back on stage.
Serafimo, your disguise is perfect.
can this be?
Gentle wife, admit your loving husband, my love. I am called to England on affairs of state, and must leave you with your new maid. Though I'd happily take the maid with me.
The old fool is leaving.
I suspect my young bride is untrue to me. I shall not leave, but shall hide over there to observe her. Adieu!
Adieu!
He goes to the door and, pretending to leave, opens it, shuts it, then hides and watches the action.
Serafimo, away with this pretense. You cannot speak, but kiss me in my husband's absence. Poor fool, he makes me laugh. Oh, 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 oh. Time I tried to get a better, better half. Poor fool, he doesn't know. Oh, 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 oh. Oh, 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 it'd be better if he knew the truth, he'd never, ever go.
Carlotta, let's fly a few. Fiorituri, the Phantom's theme, he's here, begins to loom in. Suddenly from nowhere we hear the voice of the Phantom.
Did I not instruct that box 5 was to be kept empty?
He's here, the Phantom of the Opera.
It's him. I know it. It's him.
Your part is silent, little toad.
Toad. Perhaps it is you. Toad.
Maestro, we go back to my recitavo. Serafimo, away with this pretense. You cannot speak, but kiss me in my...
Instead of singing, she emits a great croak like a toad. A stunned silence.
Carlotta's amazed as the unbidden being himself and continues, more perturbing, however, as it is. The phantom is lying quiet, first more stare-crying. Poor fool, he makes me laugh.
As before, the phantom's laughter rises, croaking continues as the chandelier's lights blink on and off. The phantom's laughter rises, time overpowering, crescendos into a great cry.
Behold, she is singing to bring down the chandelier.
Non posso più. I cannot go on.
Cara, cara, a beer, it's alright, come, a beer!
Andre, who was on stage, Piangi ushers the now sobbing Carlotta off stage while the managers tackle the audience.
Ladies and gentlemen, we apologize. The performance will continue in 10 minutes' time. When the role of the Countess will be sung by Miss Christine Daae.
Raoul?
Don't worry, I'm with you.
Yes, well, in the meantime, ladies and gentlemen, we shall be giving you the ballet for Act 3 of tonight's opera. Maestro, bring the ballet forward. The ballet, now!
Andre returns to the box. The stage is cleared and music starts again. The ballet girls enter. As a sylvan glade flies in, they begin the dance of the country nymphs. Upstage, behind the drop, a series of threatening shadows of the Phantom. Meg is aware of them and dances out of step. When this culminates in one gigantic, oppressive, bat-like shadow, the garroted body of Joseph Bouquet falls onto the stage, causing the Sylvan Glade to fly out. Raoul rushes out of his box, silence. Then pandemonium, pounding music begins, calling for help.
Raoul! Raoul!
Raoul runs on stage and embraces her. Femmer attempts to placate the audience as stagehands. Policemen crowd onto the stage. Christine and Raoul hurry off.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain in your seats. Do not panic. It's an accident. Simply an accident.
Blackout. The voices of Christine and Ruel are heard in the darkness.
Christine, come with me.
We must go to the roof. We'll be safe there.
The roof of the opera house. A huge statue of Victoire Allée, the same as that which tops the proscenium, surmounts a dome. It is twilight. A panorama of stars, roofs, chimneys, and street lamps, and spires visible in the distance. Light spills from a stairwell leading down to the opera house, and from this, Christine and Raoul rush on. She is in an incoherent frenzy of blind terror, he constantly interjecting in an attempt to calm her.
Why have you brought me here?
Take me back there.
Must return.
You kill me.
Till now.
His eyes will find me there. Those eyes that burn. And if he has to kill 1,000 men, the Phantom of the Opera will kill and kill again.
Phantom of the Opera.
My God, who is this man who hunts to kill?
This mask of death.
I can't escape from him.
This voice you hear with every breath. And in
this labyrinth,
where night is blind,
the
phantom of the opera
is here,
inside your mind.
My mind.
There is no phantom of the opera.
Raoul, I've been there, to his world of unending night. To a world where the daylight dissolves into darkness. Darkness. Raoul, I've seen him. Can I ever forget that sight? Can I ever escape from that face so distorted, deformed? It was hardly a face in that darkness. Darkness. But his voice filled my spirit with a strange, sweet sound. In the night, there was music in my mind. And from music, my soul began to sing. And I heard things I've never heard before.
What you heard was a dream and nothing more.
Yet in his eyes, all the sadness of the world. Those pleading that both threaten and adore.
Christine.
What was that?
Oh, Christine.
Oh, Raoul.
Moment as their eyes meet, the mood changes.
No more talk of darkness. Forget these wide-eyed fears. I'm here with you, beside you. My words will warm and calm you. Let me be your freedom. Let daylight dry your tears. I'm here with you, beside you, to guard you and to guide you.
Sing me every waking moment. Turn my head with talk of summertime. Say me with you now ways. Promise me that all you say is true. That's all I ask of you.
Let me be your shelter. Let me be your light. You're safe. No one will find you. Your fears are far behind you.
All I want is freedom, a world with no more night, and you always beside me, to hold me and to hide me.
Then say you'll share with me one love, one lifetime. Let me lead you from your solitude. Say you need me with you here beside you. Anywhere you go, let me go too. Christine, that's all I ask of you.
With me, one love, one lifetime. Say the word and I will follow you.
Share each day with me, each night, each morning.
Say you love me.
You know I do. Love me, that's all I ask of you.
They kiss.
Anywhere you go, let me go too. Love me, that's all I ask of you.
They kiss again. Suddenly we hear off stage the distant sound of a street barrel organ. Christine starts from her reverie.
I must go. They'll wonder where I am. Wait for me, Raoul.
Christine, I love you.
Order your fine horses. Be with them at the door.
And soon you'll be beside me.
You'll guard me and you'll guide me.
They hurry off. The phantom emerges from behind the statue.
I gave you my music, made your song take wing, and now how you've repaid me, denied me and betrayed me. He was bound to love you when he heard you sing. Christine.
Christine. Say you'll share with me one love, one lifetime. Say the words and I will follow you. Share each day with me, each night, each morning.
You will curse the day you did not do. Oh, that the phantom asked of you.
As the roof of the opera house disappears, we hear loud applause. The opera curtain closes and the principals and El Muto appear through it for their bows. Christine is conspicuously dressed in Carlotta's costume. Simultaneously, we hear the maniacal laughter of the phantom and see him high above the stage, perilously rocking the chandelier. The lights of the chandelier begin flickering, and at a great cry from him, it descends, swinging more and more madly over the orchestra pit.
Go!
The chandelier falls to the stage at Christine's feet. End of Act One. Act Two, 6 months later, Scene One. The staircase of the opera house, New Year's Eve. A gauze half conceals the tableau of guests at the opera ball. The guests, whom we cannot yet see clearly, are in fancy dress. A peacock, a lion, a dragon, Mephistopheles, a highwayman, a clown, knights, ladies, Louis XVI, Napoleon, an executioner. Monsieur André enters. He is dressed as a skeleton in an opera cape. Almost immediately, Monsieur Fermier arrives. He is also dressed as a skeleton in an opera cape. They both have champagne glasses. The two skeletons see each other and approach nervously.
Monsieur Fermin?
Monsieur André?
Each raises his mask to the other. They recognize each other. Relief and laughter.
Dear André, what a splendid party.
The prologue to a bright new year.
Quite a night, I'm impressed.
Well, one does one's best. Here's to us. A toast to all the city.
Such a pity that the Phantom can't be here!
The gauze lifts fully to reveal the staircase of the opera house. The opera ball begins. Among the guests are four carrying strange percussion instruments. A monkey with cymbals and toy soldiers with a drum, a triangle and bells. Together they play weirdly throughout.
Faces on parade, masquerade, hide your face so the world will never find you. Masquerade, every face a different shade. Masquerade, look around, there's another mask behind you. Flash of mobs, flash of puce, fool and king, ghoul and goose, green and black, queen and priest, trace of rouge, face of beast, faces. Take your turn, take a ride on the merry-go-round in the human race. Eye of gold, thigh of blue, true is false, who is who? Curl of lips, swirl of gown, ace of hearts, face of clown, faces. Drink it in, drink it up till you've drowned in the light and the sound.
But who can
name the mates?
Masquerade! Spinning yellow, spinning red! Masquerade, take your fill, let the spectacle astound you. Masquerade, burning glances, turning heads. Masquerade, stop and set at the seas of smiles around you.
Masquerade, sleeping shadows, breathing lies. Masquerade.
You can fool any friend who ever knew you.
Masquerade! Bearing out his burning eyes.
Masquerade! Running high when a face will still pursue you.
The ensemble body becomes background as André, Fermier, Meg, Giri, Piangi, and Carlotta come to the fore, glasses in hand.
What a night.
What a crowd.
Makes you glad.
Makes you proud. All the
creme.
Watching us, watching them.
And all our fears are in the past.
Six months. Of relief.
Of delight.
Of relief.
And we can breathe at last.
No more notes.
No more ghost.
Here's a help.
Here's a toast. To a prosperous year.
To the new year.
And may it spread or never fade.
6 months.
What a joy.
What a change.
What a blessed release.
And what a masquerade.
They clink glasses and move off. Raoul and Christine emerge. She is admiring a new acquisition, an engagement ring from Raoul, which she has attached to a gold chain around her neck.
Think of it, a secret engagement. Look, your future bride. Just think of it.
But why is it secret? What have we to hide?
You promised me.
Oh, you promised me.
No, Raoul, please don't. They'll see.
Don't let them see. It's an engagement, not a crime. Christine, what are you afraid of?
Let's not argue.
Let's not argue.
Please pretend.
I can only hope I'll understand in time.
Dance section in which Christine, almost coquettish, almost jittery, goes from man to man. But too many of her partners seem to be replicas of the Phantom, and each spins her with increasing force. Eventually, Raoul rescues her and holds her tightly. He whirls her back into the dance as the music head towards the climax.
Masquerade! Paper faces on parade! Masquerade! Hide your face so the world will never find you! Masquerade! Ever face a different shade! Masquerade! Look around, there's another mask behind you! Masquerade! Burning glances, burning heads! Masquerade! Stop and stare at the sea of smiles around you! Masquerade! Grinning yellows, grinning reds! Masquerade! Let you feel that the spectacle astound you!
At the height of the activity, a grotesque figure suddenly appears at the top of the staircase, 10 feet tall. Dressed all in crimson with a death's head visible inside the hood of his robe. The Phantom has come to the party. With dreadful wooden steps, he descends the stairs and takes the center of the stage.
Why so silent, good monsieur? Did you think that I have left you for good? Have you missed me, good monsieur? I have written you an opera. Here I bring the finished score, Don Juan triumphant. I advise you to comply. My instructions should be clear. Remember, there are worse things than a shattered chandelier.
Christine, mesmerized, approaches as the Phantom beckons her. He reaches out, grasps the chain that holds the secret engagement ring, and rips it from her throat. He holds it aloft.
Your chains are still mine. You will sing for me.
He turns his back, all cower and suspense, as the music crescendos, until suddenly, in a fiery flash, the Phantom has vanished. A stunned silence broken by the sound of demonic laughter. All turn upstage towards the source of the laughter and see, standing majestic and eerie at the top of the staircase, the mocking figure of the Phantom. All turn upstage towards the source of the laughter and see, standing majestic and eerie at the top of the staircase. Oh, it's the same thing. The figure of the Phantom. All disperse in panic. A gloomy corridor backstage. Jiri is hurrying across through the gloom. Raoul appears and calls after her.
Madame Jiri! Madame Jiri!
Monsieur, don't ask me. I know no more than anyone else.
That's not true. You've seen something, haven't you?
I don't know what I've seen. Please don't ask me, monsieur.
Madame, for all of our sakes.
Very well. It was years ago. There was a traveling fair in the city. Tumblers, conjurers, human oddities.
Go on.
And there was... I shall never forget him. A man. Locked in a cage.
In a cage?
A prodigy, monsieur. Scholar, architect, musician.
Composer.
And an inventor, too, monsieur. They boasted he had once built for the Shah of Persia a maze of mirrors.
Who was this man?
A freak of nature, more monster than man.
Deformed.
From birth, it seemed.
My God.
And then he went missing. He escaped.
Go on.
They never found him. It was said he had died.
But he didn't die, did he?
The world forgot him, but I never can. For in this darkness, I have seen him again.
And so this phantom's this man.
I have said too much, monsieur. And there have been too many accidents.
Accidents?
Too many.
No, wait! Madame Jury!
The manager's office, the phantom score lies open on the desk. André impatiently flicking through it. Vermeer sorting through papers, letters, etc.
Ludicrous! Have you seen the score?
Be ludicrous!
It's the final straw!
This is lunacy! Well, you know my views!
Utter lunacy!
But we daren't refuse!
Not another chandelier.
Look, my friend, what we have here.
He has two notes from the Phantom, one of which he hands to André, who opens it and reads.
Dear André Rimet Orchestrations, we need another first bassoon. Get a player with tone, and the third trombone has to go. The man could not be deafer, so please preferably one who plays in tune.
Dear Furman vis-a-vis my opera, some chorus members must be sacked. If you could find out which has a sense of pitch, wisely though, I've managed to assign a rather minor role to those who cannot act.
Ugh. They are interrupted by the arrival of Carletta and Piangi, both furiously brandishing the score.
Outrage!
What is it now?
This whole affair is an outrage!
What is the matter?
Have you seen the size of my pot?
You're a listen.
It's an insult!
Fuck you as well.
Just look at this, it's an insult!
Please understand.
Signora.
The things I have to do for my art!
If you call this gibberish art!
Ah, here's our little flower.
I'm dying.
You have secured the Lord's role in this Don Juan.
Christine Daae, she doesn't have the voice.
Can I take off my ring?
She's behind this.
It appears we have no choice.
She's the one behind this, Christine Daae!
How dare you?
I'm not a fool.
You evil woman, how dare you?
You think I'm blind?
This isn't my fault. I don't want any part in this plot.
It's Daae, sure.
But why not?
What does she say?
Your decision.
But why not?
She's backing out.
You have a duty.
I cannot say it's duty or not.
Christine, you don't have to. They can't make you.
She is prevented from replying by the arrival of Jiri, arrives bearing another note from the Phantom.
Please, monsieur, another note.
The manager's groan gesture read it as she reads. All react variously as they are singled out.
Fondest greetings to you all. A few instructions just before rehearsal starts. Carlotta must be taught to act.
Not her normal trick of strutting round the stage. Our Don Juan must lose some weight. It's not healthy at a man of Piangi's age. And my managers must learn that their place is in an office not the arts. As for Miss Christine Daae, no doubt she'll do her best. It's true her voice is good. She knows, though, should she wish to excel, she has much still to learn. If pride will let her, return to me, her teacher, her teacher. Your obedient friend.
And Angel. I can't. I won't do it.
A pause. Attention now focuses on Raoul, whose eyes are suddenly bright with a new thought.
We have all been blind, and yet the answer is staring us in the face. This could be our chance to ensnare our clever friend.
We're listening. Go on.
We shall play his game, perform his work, but remember we hold the ace, for if Miss Daae sings, he is certain to attend.
We make certain the doors are barred.
We make certain our men are there.
We make certain they're armed. The curtain falls.
His reign will end.
All have been listening intently. Jiri is the first to express a reaction. Christine remains silent and withdrawn.
Madness!
I'm not so sure.
Not if it works.
This is madness.
The tide will turn.
Monsieur, believe me, there is no way of turning the tide.
You stick to ballet.
Help us.
Monsieur, I can't.
Instead of warning us, help,
help us.
Help us.
I wish I could.
Don't make excuses.
Or could it? You're on this side.
She's his accomplice.
Monsieur, believe me, I intend no ill. But monsieur, be careful.
We have seen him still.
We say he'll fall, and fall he will.
She's the one behind this, Christine!
This is the truth!
This is all her doing!
Christine Daae!
Free us all! This so-called angel has to fall.
What glory can she hope to gain? It's clear to all the girls insane.
She is crazy! She is raving!
Please don't.
You're muted.
Bursting through the hubbub with a great cry.
You're muted.
Oh, Raoul, I'm frightened. Don't make me do this. Raoul, it scares me. Don't put me through this ordeal by fire. He'll take me, I know. We'll be parted forever. He won't let me go. What I once used to dream, now I dread. If he finds me, it won't ever end. And he'll always be there singing songs in my head. He'll always be there singing songs in my head.
She's mad.
You said yourself he was nothing but a man. Yet while he lives, he will haunt us till we're dead.
Twisted every way, what answer can I give? Am I to risk my life to win the chance to live? Can I betray the man who once inspired my voice? Do I become his prey? Do I have any choice? He kills without a thought. He murders all that's good. I know I can't refuse. And yet I wish I could. Oh God, if I agree, what horrors wait for me in this, the Phantom's Opera.
Christine, Christine, don't think that I don't care, but every hope and every prayer rests on you now.
With a great surge, the orchestra takes over. Christine, overcome by conflicting emotion, turns her face away and hurries out. Raoul calls after her.
Christine! So, it is to be war between us. But this time, clever friend, disaster will be yours!
As lights fade, attendants stretch a red velvet rope across the downstage area. Others bring unglitched chairs. Carlotta Piangi and Jiri move downstage to take their places for the next scene. Scene 4, a rehearsal for Don Juan Triumphant. Rare supervises the learning of the new piece from the piano. Present are Piangi, Christine, Carlotta, and Jiri in chorus.
Bide our sword now, wounded knight, your vainglory's gasconade. Bright to you your final fight, for your ride high price you've paid.
Silken couch and hay-filled barn.
Those who tangle with Don Juan.
Name.
Turn off ESPN.
Wait a minute.
72.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Lee, Senor Ponte, if you please. I did it.
You have more, Travis.
That was just the chorus line. I do my best, but I do not understand.
Where are you?
Travis.
Oh, wait, that's not me.
Where am I? The middle of 72.
No.
Those 10.
Those who tangled with Don Juan!
Oh, yeah. His way is better. At least he make a sound like music.
Signora, would you speak that way in the presence of the composer?
The composer is not here. And if he were here, I would...
Are you certain of that, Signora?
So, once again, please, Signora, after seven, five, six, seven.
Those who tango with Don Juan!
Oh, pure non posso! What does it matter what notes he sing?
Those who ten is right.
Have patience, Signora.
No one will know if it is right or if it is wrong. No one will care if it is right or if it is wrong.
Ladies, Signora Piangi, if you, for the second time, please.
Jiri thumps the piano keys, leaves the piano, and attempts to attract attention by using signals.
I do my best, but I do not understand.
You sing well that part, man, though.
Don't listen to them, Caro.
You. I'm sure that you will do more than justice to the role.
There's no beauty, no music.
Settle down.
Sisati, mi turati l'animal!
By this time, the members of the chorus are behaving in a similar manner. At the height of the mayhem, the piano suddenly begins to demonstrate the music unaided. It plays with great force and rhythm. All fall silent and freeze, then suddenly start to sing the piece robotically and accurately. As they continue to sing, Christine moves away from the group. ensemble comes back around, and Christine, transfixed by a ghostly figure, sings independently.
In sleep he sang to me, in dreams he came. That voice which calls to me and speaks my name.
The scene begins to change. Trance-like Christine moves slowly upstage. We hear the distant sound of bells.
Little Lottie thought of everything and nothing. Her father promised her that he would send her the angel of music. Her father promised her. Her father promised her.
A graveyard in Perros. A mausoleum with hanging moss in the center, a pyramid of skulls in front of a cross. Two statues in mourning. It is dusk.
You once my one companion. You were all that mattered. You were once a friend and father. Then my world was shattered. Wishing you were somehow here again. Wishing you were somehow near. Sometimes it seemed if I just dreamed, somehow you are here. Wishing I could hear your voice again, knowing that I never would. Dreaming of you won't help me to do all that you dreamed I could. Passing bells and sculpted angels, cold and monumental, seem for you the wrong companions. You were warm and gentle. Too many years fighting back tears. Why can't the past just die? Wishing you were somewhere again. Wish knowing we must say goodbye. Try to forgive, teach me to live. Give me the strength to try. No more memories, no more silent tears, no more gazing across the wasted years. Help me say goodbye. Help me say goodbye.
The phantom emerges from behind the cross.
Wandering child, so lost, so helpless, yearning for my guidance.
To a father, friend, or phantom, who is it there staring?
Have you forgotten your angel?
Angelos. What endless longings echo in this whisper.
Raoul appears in the shadows and watches for a moment transfixed.
Too long you've wandered in winter.
Once again she is here.
Far from my far-reaching gaze.
Once again she returns.
Quietly my mind beats against you.
Resist.
At the soul
of
the arms of angel or
angel of music, you denied me, turning from your beauty. Angel of music, you shunned me, come to strange angel. I am your angel of music. Come to me, angel of music.
Angel of darkness, cease this torment.
I am your angel of music. Come to me, angel of music.
Leave her. You have no claim on her. Leave her. Your words are wasted. Can't you see she'll never be yours?
I am your angel of music. Come to me, angel of music.
Christine, listen to me. Whatever you may believe, this man, this thing, is not your father. Let her go, for God's sakes. Let her go! Christine!
Raoul!
She turns to Raoul, who embraces her protectively. The phantom freezes for a moment and then suddenly seizes a pike upon which is impaled a skull. At a movement from him, a flash of fire streaks from the gaping mouth of the skull and lands at Raoul's feet.
Bravo, monsieur! Such spirited words!
More tricks, another monsieur. Fireball.
Let's see, monsieur, how far you dare to go.
More deception, more violence.
Raoul, no.
Raoul has begun to walk slowly and resolutely toward the phantom. The fireball is always landing just ahead of him.
That's right, monsieur. Keep walking this way.
You can't win her love by making her your prisoner.
Raoul, don't.
Stay back.
I'm here, monsieur, the angel of death. Come on, monsieur. Don't stop.
Three more fireballs. Raoul is almost at the phantom's feet. A confrontation is imminent when Christine suddenly rushes across to Raoul.
Raoul, come back.
I'm not afraid of you. Your words are wasted.
Don't go. So be it. Now let it be war upon you both.
At a gesture from the phantom, there is a flash of lighting, and the stage erupts into flame, blackout. We immediately hear the oboe A of the next scene. The stage of the opera house before the premiere of Don Juan triumphant. An oboe sounds an A, and the orchestra begins to tune. A whistle sounds, the chief fire officers reviewing two fire marshals in tin helmets. A work light on a stand illuminates them. The orchestra continues to tune and warm up throughout the scene. Also present are Raoul, André, and Femmer, surprising the proceedings, and a marksman at present, hidden in the pit.
You understand your instructions?
Sir.
When you hear a whistle, take upon your position. I shall then instruct you to secure the doors if it is essential that all doors are properly secured.
Doing the right thing, André?
Have you got a better idea?
Monsieur Le Comte, may I give the order?
Give the order.
The chief blows his whistle. The firemen fan out, leaving Raoul, the chief, and the managers on stage. The orchestra has now completed tuning, and individual players can now be heard practicing fragments of the Don Juan score.
You in the pit. Do you have a clear view of that box?
Yes, sir.
Remember, when the time comes, shoot. Only if you have to, but shoot to kill.
How will I know, sir?
You'll know.
Monsieur Le Vicomte, are you confident this will work? Will Miss Daye sing?
Don't worry, Fearman. Andre.
We're in your hands, sir.
Are the doors secure? Oh, my, sorry. My men are now in position, sir.
Go ahead, then.
Now are the doors more insecure.
The orchestra falls silent. Exit doors are slammed all over the building, the firemen answering one by one, secure, etc. A short
secure.
Pause, we hear the echo of the last door, very quietly from nowhere. We hear the voice of the Phantom.
I'm here, the Phantom of the Opera.
All look around apprehensively. Firemen start to run in the direction of the voice.
I'm here, the Phantom of the Opera.
I'm here! I'm here! I'm here!
Again, they follow the voice. This happens several times, the Phantom's voice darting more and more bewilderingly from place to place. Finally, it is heard from Box 5, and in the confusion, the marksman fires a shot. Roll rounds on the marksman furiously.
Idiot! You'll kill someone! I said only when the time comes!
But, Monsieur Le Vicomte!
No buts. For once, Monsieur Le Victim is right. Steal my fate tonight. I hate to have to cut the fun short. But the joke's wearing thin. Let the audience in. Let my opera begin.
The Don Juan Overture begins, all disperse as scene and lights change when the lamplighter illuminates the stage. The premiere of Don Juan Triumphant. The set of the final scene of Don Juan Triumphant, a huge hall with an arch behind the arch, which has curtains as a bed, a fine table laid for two. Pasorino, Don Juan's servant, is directing the staff as they make the room ready. They are a crowd of 16th century ruffians and hoydens. A page innkeeper's wife, etc., proud of their master's reputation as libertine.
Here the sire may serve the dam, here the master takes his meat, here the sacrificial lamb utters one despairing bleat.
Oh, young maiden! For the thrill on your tongue of stolen sweets, you will have to bear the bill, tangled in the winding sheets. Serve the meal and serve the maid, serve the master, serve the queen. Tables, plans, and maids are laid. Don't run, trials, what's up?
Pianjian's Don emerges from behind the arch. He snaps his fingers, Meg and the gypsy dancer follows. She pirouettes coquettishly for him, throws her purse, she catches it, kisses him, and leaves.
Listen, more, my faithful friend! Once again, recite the plan!
Our young guest believes the man.
When you met who wore your cloak, she could have seen your face. She believes he dines with you in your master's barrel place. Your duty will scoff and quaff, stealing what in truth in mind, when its latent modesty starts to mellow with the wine.
Slam the door, my crack-a-doo.
I shall say, come hide with me, oh, where of course my room.
Poor thing has not a chance.
Here's my hat, my cloak, and sword. Request is assured if I forget myself in love.
Laughing, Don Juan puts on Sabino's cloak and goes into the curtain alcove where the bed waits. Although we do not yet know it, the Punjab lasso has done its work, and Signor Pianji is no more. When next we see Don Juan, it'll be the Phantom. Meanwhile, we hear Aminta singing happily in the distance.
But thoughts of joy, no dreams within her heart, but dreams of love.
Master!
Passerino, go away, for the trap is set and waits for its prey.
Passerino leaves. Christine enters. A pretty adventurous girl, or she would not be here. She takes off her cloak and sits down, looks about her, no one. She starts on a leg of chicken. The Phantom, disguised as Don Juan, pretending to be Passerino, emerges. He now wears Passerino's robe, the cowl of which hides his face. His first words startle her.
You have come here in pursuit of your deepest urge, in pursuit of that wish which till now has been silent, silent. I have brought you that our passions may fuse and merge. In your mind you've already succumbed to me, dropped all defenses, completely succumbed to me. Now you're here with me, no second thoughts, you've decided, decided. Past the point of no return, no backward glances. The game we've played till now are at an end. Past all thought of if or when. No use resisting. Abandon thought and let the dream descend. What raging fire shall flood the soul? What rich desire unlocks its door? What sweet seduction lies before us? Past the point of no return, the final threshold, what warm unspoken secrets will we learn beyond the point of no return?
Hold me to that moment when words run dry, to that moment when speech disappears into silence, silence. I have come here, hardly in my mind, ready imagined our bodies entwining, defenseless and silent. Now I am here with you, no second thoughts, I've decided, decided. Past the point of no return, no going back now, our passion played has now at last begun. Past all thought of right or wrong, one final question, how long should we to wait before we're one? When will the blood begin to race, the sleeping bud burst into bloom? When will the flames at last consume us?
Past the point of no return,
the final
final
threshold.
The
bridge is crossed, so stand and watch it burn. We pass the point of no return.
By now, the audience and the police have realized that Signor Pianchi is dead behind the curtain. And it is the phantom who sings in his place. Christine knows it too. As final confirmation, the phantom sings.
Say you'll share with me one love, one lifetime. Lead me, save me from my solitude.
He takes from his finger a ring and holds it out to her. It is the same ring, Christine's engagement ring, which he had torn from her throat at the beginning of Act Two. Slowly, she takes it and puts it on her finger.
Say you want me with you here, beside you. Anywhere you go, let me go too. Christine, that's all I ask of.
We never reach the word you, for Christine quiet, calmly reveals the phantom's face to the audience. As the forces of law close in on the horrifying skull, the phantom sweeps his cloak around her and vanishes. Meg pulls the curtain upstage, revealing Pianchi's body carotid, propped against the bed, his head gruesomely tilted to one side. She screams. Transformation to reverse view of the stage. The house curtains upstage close. Police, stagehands, etc. rush onto the stage in confusion. Also Andre, Femme, Raoul, Giri, and Carletta and Meg.
What is it? What has happened? Ubaldo!
Oh, my,
oh
God.
My God.
We're ruined. Oh, my darling. Who has done this? You! Why did you let this happen?
She breaks down.
You're muted.
Monsieur Le Vicomte, come with me. I know where they are.
But can I trust you?
You must. But remember, keep your hand at the level of your eyes.
But why?
Why? The Punjab lasso, monsieur. First Bouquet, now Pianchi.
Like this, monsieur. I'll come with you.
No, Meg, no. You stay here. Come with me, monsieur. Do as I say, but hurry, or we shall be too late.
The labyrinth underground. Meanwhile, down below, the candles that line the lake rise from the floor. We see the phantom, Christine in the boat crossing the underground lake.
Down once more to the dungeon of my black despair. Down we plunge to the prison of my mind. Down that path into the darkness deep as hell. Why, you ask, was I bound in chain in this cold and dismal place? Not for any mortal sin, but the wickedness of my foreign face.
Track down this murderer, he must be found.
Hounded out by everyone, met with hatred everywhere. No kind word from anyone, no compassion anywhere. Christine, why? Why?
They disappear. Raoul and Giri appear above. They hold their hands up just as well, for a noose descends over Raoul, and he is able to free himself.
Your hand at the level of your eyes.
At the level of your eyes.
Your hand at the level of your eyes.
This taunting chorus continues as Raoul and Giri make their way down to the edge of the lake. They meet a pack of rats. Giri screams and lowers her guard. The rats and the rat catcher pass them. Giri raises her hand.
He lives across the lake, monsieur. This is as far as I dare go.
Madame Giri, thank you.
She turns to go back up the slope. Raoul looks at the water. He removes his coat and plunges in. The mob appears at the top of the zigzag slope. They come down to the lake edge, their torches flickering.
Track down this murderer. He must be found. Hunt out this animal who runs to ground. Too long he's preyed on us, but we now know the Phantom of the Opera is here, deep down below. He's here, the Phantom of the Opera. He's here, the Phantom of the Opera.
They turn back up the slope. Perhaps there's another way in. The gate to the lair descends, shutting the boat from view as the rest of the lair appears. Beyond the lake, the dummy of Christine sits crumpled on a large throne, wearing a white wedding veil. The Phantom enters, dragging Christine roughly. She is wearing a white wedding dress. She frees herself and backs away as he stares blackly out front. Braving her terror, she addresses him fiercely.
Have you gorged yourself and lost in your lust for blood? Am I now to be prey to your lust for flesh?
That's fate, which condemns me to wallow in blood, has also denied me the joys of the flesh. This face, the infection which poisons our love. This face, which earned a mother's fear and loathing, a mask, my first unfeeling scrap of clothing. Pity comes too late. Turn around and face your fate. An eternity of this before your eyes.
They are almost touching. She looks calmly and coldly into his face.
This haunted face holds no horror for me now. It's in your soul that the true distortion lies.
A stunned silence is broken as the Phantom suddenly senses Raoul's presence behind the portcullis. Raoul climbs out of the water.
Wait, I think, my dear, we have a guest.
Raoul!
Sir, this is indeed an unparalleled delight. I had rather hoped that you would come, and now my wish come true. You have truly made my night.
Free her! Do what you like, only free her! Have you no pity?
Your lover makes a passionate plea.
Please, Raoul, it's useless.
I love her. Does that mean nothing? I love her. Show some compassion.
The world show no compassion to me.
Christine, Christine. Let me see her.
Be my guest, sir.
He gestures and the fence rises. Raoul staggers in, embracing Christine.
Monsieur, I bid you welcome. Did you think that I would harm her? Why should I make her pay for the sins which are yours?
So saying, he takes the Punjab lasso, and before Raoul has a chance to move, catches him by the neck. The end of the rope, of which the Phantom has let go, remains magically suspended in midair.
Order your fine horses now. Raise up your hand to the level of your eyes. Nothing can save you now, except perhaps Christine. Start a new life with me. Buy his freedom with your love. Refuse me, and you send your lover to his death. This is the choice. This is the point of no return.
The tears I might have shed for your dark fate grow cold and turn to tears of hate.
Christine, forgive me, please forgive me. I did it all for you and all for nothing.
False friend, we had such hopes, and
too
now those hopes
for turning back. Too late for prayers and useless pity. Past all hope of cries for help.
No
fighting. Whether way you choose, you cannot win. So do you end your days with me. or do you send him to his grave?
Why well, make her lie to you to save me?
Past the point of no return, the final threshold. His life is now the price which you must earn. You've passed the point of no return.
Gave my mind blindly.
You try my patience. Make your choice.
Pitiful creature of darkness. What kind of life have you known? God, give me courage to show you you are not.
Now calmly facing him, she kisses him long and full on the lips. The embrace lasts a long time. Raoul watches in horror and wonder. The moment is broken as we hear the beating footsteps of the mob off stage. The phantom lakes a lighted candle and holds it above Raoul's head. The tense moment, but the suspended rope suddenly falls harmlessly. The phantom has burned the thread by which the noose was held. Resigned, he addresses Raoul as we hear the offstage voices of the approaching mob.
Track down the murderer. He must be found.
Take her. Forget me. Forget all of this.
Who is this monster, the murdering beast? Hunt out this animal who runs to ground.
Leave me alone. Forget all you've seen. Go now. Don't let them find you.
Revenge for Pianji. Revenge for Paquet.
Take the boat. Swear to me never to tell.
Too long he's preyed on us.
The secret you know of the angel in hell.
But now we know the creature must never go free.
Go.
The Phantom of the Opera is there, deep down below.
Go now. Go now. And leave me.
Raoul and Christine move off towards the boat. The musical box starts up magically and the Phantom listens to it.
Masquerade. Paper faces on parade. Masquerade. Hide your face so the world will never find you.
Christine re-enters and walks slowly towards him. She takes off her ring and gives it to the Phantom.
Christine, I love you.
She hurries off. The Phantom puts that ring on his finger.
With me one lifetime. Say the word and I will follow you.
Share each day with me.
Each night.
Each morning. You alone can make my song take flight. It's over now. The music of the night.
The Phantom walks slowly towards the throne and sits on it, gathering his cloak around him. At the same time, the mob, including Meg, appears above, climbing down the portcullis. By the time they have reached the bottom and entered the lair, the Phantom has entirely covered himself with the cloak. Meg crosses to the throne and, tentatively but courageously, pulls the cloak away, revealing empty air. The Phantom has vanished, leaving only his white mask. In wonder, Meg reaches out and picks up his mask in her small hand. The curtain, the end of the opera.
All right. All right. The opera. Thank you, everyone, for participating. Thank you, everyone, for watching.